Well, we're going to pick up at verse 21 of chapter 16, but it's so important to remind ourselves of last Sunday, where Matthew's gospel, going all the way back to the start, had been leading up to this great declaration by Peter, there where Jesus asked, "Who do you say that I am?" to the disciples, and Peter said, "You're the Christ, you're the Son of the living God." And Jesus, of course, said, "Ah, blessed are you, Peter," and talked about how God had revealed this to him and began to say some more things. But then, interestingly, and we looked at this last Sunday, verse 20 says, Jesus commanded the disciples, "Now don't go and tell anybody about this." And we're going to see a little bit as to why as we continue on, because they don't really understand what it means for Jesus to be the Christ in terms of the earthly destiny that is awaiting down the road. So verse 21, and this is, like I say, this is a pivotal moment in the gospel. Notice even the language. "From that time, Jesus began to show to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised the third day." So there's a lot in that verse. But notice, now Jesus begins, and only now does he begin to explain to them that death awaits him. Crucifixion is in his future. He has not said this to them up until now. Only in connection with Peter saying, "You are the Christ," that we then see Jesus explain what that actually means in terms of his immediate future. He must go to Jerusalem. The bulk of the ministry, of course, has been in the Galilee region and the areas around there. You would think, well, if your enemies are in Jerusalem, just don't go. No, I must go to Jerusalem. There is a destiny there. And you see the elders and chief priests and scribes, even though those are different groups of people, but they're written as a common enemy against him. He's going to be killed there. But also notice, he promises, even in mentioning his future death, he also mentions the resurrection with it. And how many times do we say that you must look at both together? They must be coupled. It is not simply that he died on the cross, but that he conquered the grave and rose on the third day. He tells both to the disciples. But we know from later on, as we're going to get to it, they just did not make the connection. Do we see the disciples after Jesus is crucified, you know, look at their watches and say, "How long before the resurrection?" You know, no, they think it's over. They think it's a disaster. There's something about us, isn't there, where when we're hit with shocking news, and certainly when they were told, "I'm going to die, I'm going to be killed," that was shocking news once they realized he's the Christ and now he's going to be killed. Wait a minute. That when we hear such news, we often don't hear what follows it. If you're ever in a medical situation, sometimes you hear something and it's heavy and you don't hear the rest of the discussion because your mind just starts racing and you kind of tune out the message. And that must be something that happened to them as well, because they are certainly not expecting the resurrection, as we're going to see when the time comes. But then Peter, now talk about going from the heights to the depths. Peter took Jesus aside, "Come here, Lord," and began to rebuke him, saying, "Far be it from you, Lord, this shall not happen to you." And Jesus turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are an offense to me, for you are not mindful of the things of God, but the things of men." Wow. Now, there is no need to jump to an extreme thinking that somehow, you know, Peter was possessed by the devil at this moment. But he is speaking the devil's language. When he says, "Get behind me, Satan," it reminds us all the way back to the very start of Jesus' earthly ministry. You recall, Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist, And then the Spirit drove him into the wilderness immediately. And he was tempted by the devil in the wilderness. And three of those temptations are specifically recorded for us in the Scripture, one of which was when Satan showed him all the kingdoms of the world and says, look, they're all mine. I'll give them to you. Just bow your knee. Worship me. Now, we don't know to the extent that Satan understood the cross that awaited Jesus' future at that time, but Jesus certainly understood it. He knew what awaited him. And so that temptation that all of those kingdoms could be his, not through the act of submission to the Father's will and sacrifice and the shame and the pain of the cross, but rather just listen to Satan. And so here, Peter is in effect saying, look, you don't have to go to the cross. You're not going to go to the cross. This is not right for you. And Jesus makes the equation. Get behind me, Satan, you're an offense. To discourage Jesus from going to the cross is to do the work of the devil. Because why? It was the Father's will for Jesus to go. And whenever we're discouraged from doing God's will in our life, well, who is at work there? The enemy. Jesus reminds him, you're thinking like a man and you're not thinking like God. Well, that's understandable. I mean, if someone's going to be killed, you think that's the end. What a disaster. It's over. That's how men would think. That closes the movement. That closes the mission. It's all over now. But that's not how God was thinking. We actually find that there's going to be victory after the crucifixion. But now, Jesus turns it around. And he gives a commandment. He gives his mandate to the disciples. And not just to those standing in front of him, but to all who would come afterwards. And he says to his disciples, verse 24, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. There is the mandate. There is the command of our Lord. And of course, it only makes sense. If Jesus is going to the cross, if he is going to earthly rejection, if he is going to hatred and shame and opposition, and we say, I want to follow Jesus, well, where are you going to follow him? You see how inconsistent it is when you hear these messages like, you know what, you just need to give your life to Jesus and he's going to make you rich and he's going to heal you of all your sicknesses and he's going to make your life wonderful. That's not promised in the Bible. God in his grace and mercy and his power sometimes does some amazing things for people. But Jesus is going to the cross, and if you're going to follow in his footsteps, you're going to follow him, that's where it leads. And he makes it very clear. Deny yourself, take up your own cross, and follow me. Now, we live in a nation and in a time where the influence of the Bible is so strong in this country that we have a lot of euphemisms and just slang and expressions that actually come from the Bible. That was one of the shocks to me when I first read the Bible at the age of 25. So I'd been on this earth for 25 years, and I started reading these things in the Bible. I said, wait a minute, I've heard that expression. I've heard that. I had no idea they were from the Scripture. You know, someone goes, boy, he could see the handwriting on the wall. I'll tell you what. You know, and that's straight from the Bible, isn't it? Well, unfortunately, though, sometimes the usage is not really faithful to what the Scripture is teaching. And one of those examples is when you hear people so often today talk about, well, you know, we all have our cross to bear. And the problem is that it's so often said in a context talking about some nuisance, some little problem, some issue. Let's say your supervisor at work is just a very mean person, you know, but he's the boss and he knows he's the boss. He just treats you like dirt and you need the paycheck and there's not much you can do or whatever. And you just say, oh, that guy, you know, he's my cross to bear. I assure you, that the disciples hearing Jesus when he said, deny yourself and take up your cross and follow me, were not thinking of anything that light. They understood clearly what a Roman crucifixion, what a cross meant. And they certainly understood what it meant when someone was carrying his own cross. That is a dead person walking. That person is about to die. And remember, crucifixions were typically staged in very public areas so that many people would see what was taking place. And so Jesus is making it clear. And again, if there's any doubt at all, he reinforces the idea in verse 25. Look at it again. You want to really save your life? Then you're going to lose it. See the equation with death and the cross. But of course, you lose your life. And notice, for my sake, for Jesus' sake. Well, that's when you find it. Now, it is true that these disciples would face martyrdom. They would literally lose their lives for Jesus' sake, as would many Christians that would come after them, as do even Christians today in various parts of the world. That is a very real possibility for one to literally lose their life for Jesus' sake because you refuse to denounce him and put to death by wicked people opposed to God. But we don't have to only take it in the most literal way. In other words, Jesus is not saying the only way that you can follow him as his disciple is martyrdom. But martyrdom is the ultimate result in, again, certain contexts of history and geography and whatnot, of someone following the Lord faithfully. Because that's what Jesus faced. And as he said, the world hate me, they're going to hate you if you live like me. How did Jesus live? Well, he loved, he served, and he spoke the truth. So you give your life to, I'm going to love people, I'm going to serve people, and I'm going to speak the truth. You think everyone's going to appreciate you, right? Did they all appreciate Jesus for doing that? No. They crucified him. And Jesus says, you're not any greater than your master. The world's going to hate you as well. He brings it all together. But you see, to seek to really save your life, you have to give it over to the Lord. To find life, to find the meaning, the purpose of our creation, why God put us here, is to enjoy that relationship with him. And the world is just filled with all sorts of options that just lead to emptiness. Like the book of Ecclesiastes, right? Solomon, he talks about, you know, I gave myself over. I decided I'd really study wisdom and intelligence, all this kind of stuff, but it's just vanity. And so then I gave myself over to pleasure and fun, and that was vanity. And so sometimes there are good pursuits in and of themselves. Sometimes they're real worldly, sinful pursuits. But whatever the pursuit is, if it's not rooted in God, it just leads to vanity and emptiness and a lack of fulfillment. God designed us that way. And so Jesus goes on to give this reasoning behind this command, this mandate that he has of discipleship. Verse 26, what profit is it to a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? What will a man give in exchange for his soul? Obviously, a very extreme. Can you imagine gaining the whole world? Imagine you are a world ruler, dictator. Literally, everybody is under your authority. All the wealth of the world ultimately belongs to you, and you can determine how it's used and all of the rest. And let's say that was the case. Okay, fine. We read about kings and queens that have ruled for 40, 50 years, but what's that when at the end of it all, you lose your soul and you go to the grave? You certainly aren't going to be able to take all of the world's power and popularity and treasures with you. And so then in a very clear point that one could certainly meditate upon, the back part of verse 26, what will a man give in exchange for his soul? What a good question. Of course, there have been movies and books about people who sell their soul to the devil. You know, oh, I want to be a famous musician, and so they make a deal with the devil, and they become famous, and that fame lasts for a few years, and then they die, and people have their legends and their stories along those lines. But it's not just legends and stories to recognize that there are people in our world that are, in effect, exchanging their soul for nothing. What keeps someone from coming to Christ and giving their life to God and receiving the forgiveness of sins? I just don't want to do that Christian thing, man. I just, you know, I like to party or whatever. So you're selling your soul so you can get drunk on Friday night? I mean, what a terrible trade that is. That's just one example. We could give many, many examples. What would a person give in exchange for a soul? The answer is, well, there's nothing that's as valuable as your soul. That's right. There's nothing. That's what Jesus is trying to say. And yet people don't recognize that. And they live for this world and the things of this world until it's too late. Now, the beautiful thing about these verses is we're not done, because Jesus now includes a wonderful promise. A glorious promise, verse 27, for the Son of Man, that's a reference to himself, will come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he will reward each according to his works. Assuredly, I say to you, there are some standing here who shall not taste death till they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. So there's a glorious promise. On the one hand, yes, deny yourself, carry your cross, lose your life to really find it, and all the rest. And it's just like heavy, heavy, down, down. But then there's this glorious promise. Oh, but one day he's coming back in the fullness of glory of God, all the angels, and he's coming with his reward. His reward is with him to give to all people according to their works. This beautiful, beautiful promise, something we anticipate and long for. Even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus. Now, we need to be clear on one very important point. Our salvation, the forgiveness of our sins, is 100% a free gift of God's grace. By grace we are saved through faith, a gift of God, not of works. None of us can boast. God has done all the work. Came to this earth, became a man, lived that perfect life, died on the cross, not for his own sins, but for yours and mine and the rest of the world, and conquered the grave on the third day and ascended into heavenly glory. He's still alive today. And our forgiveness of sins is 100% based on the merits of Jesus and us just receiving like a gift that it is. Lord Jesus, save me, a sinner. So we have to be very clear on that point. But having said that, and all that comes from that, such as our sins, we are told, are done away with, never to be remembered anymore, as far as the east is from the west, because they've been paid for. If the sin has faced justice, then why would we have to answer for it a second time? We don't. Understanding that, understand this as well. Nonetheless, all Christians will still stand before God to give an account of our lives. But there's a difference there. It's not about answering for your sins and God facing God's judgment. No, it's all about what Jesus is saying right here, the rewards and how you lived your life. And so there are a lot of verses in the Bible that talk about how, you know, God's going to bring into judgment and he's going to note every idle word and all these kind of things that are brought up in a context of Christians, and people get a little nervous and scared. But that's not the thing that should scare you, because your sins are paid for. It's a fearful thing to fall in the hands of a living God and to face his judgment and wrath, absolutely. But Christian, you're not going to face that. But we are going to give an account of our lives. And this is where the Bible talks about how there are some Christians, and this is tragic, but their whole life, when examining the work of God's examination, his fire, if you will, just as wood, hay, and stubble, and it just burns up and disappears as if it never happened. What a tragic waste of life. But that person is still saved. They're still forgiven by the blood of Jesus Christ. God will never say, you didn't do enough for me, so you're out. That's not how it works. But at the same time, there will be God's children whose lives are examined in that same fire, and it comes out gold, silver, precious stones, refined, made beautiful, perfect through God. I don't know which line I want to be in. How about you? And that's what Jesus is talking about. But to expect this wonderful reward of our Savior that he's talking about when he returns again, and to think that it's possible apart from denying yourself and picking up the cross and following him, is a mistake. But Jesus brings them together here. No doubt the disciples were very confused, as were many just Jewish people, when looking at the prophecies in the Old Testament about the coming Messiah, the Christ. You had these prophecies about this king that was going to rule and reign, and it would be a kingdom of peace and prosperity. We wouldn't learn war anymore. We would not be building military arms and all those things. All that would just be devoted into agriculture, and everyone would just be blessed and filled. Even the animal kingdom would change. I mean, it's glorious stuff under the Messiah's reign. Can't wait. And yet, then there were those prophecies that talked about a Messiah who would suffer and be rejected and die. And of course, you can imagine, how do we connect these two seemingly very different destinies of the Messiah? There was actually a Jewish teaching that was well known that there were two Messiahs. There was going to be the Messiah who would suffer, be rejected. He was connected to the line of Joseph. If you remember Joseph from the book of Genesis, how his brothers sold him into slavery in Egypt. Now, eventually he rose to power in Egypt, but he was rejected by his brothers and sent away, even though God used him in a great way. Well, there were those who saw that Messiah, and then, of course, the Messiah associated with King David. He's going to be the one who rules on the kingdom. And so they thought, hey, problem solved. We got two Messiahs. But they were wrong. It's not that there are two Messiahs, two Christs. The words are identical. No, there's only one Messiah, but he comes twice. Two different purposes in coming. Some 2,000 years ago, he came to be that one who was rejected and despised and killed. But he did so for your sins and mine. When he comes again, and that's what he's talking about right here in verse 27, it will be to set up that glorious kingdom of peace and prosperity. One Messiah, Jesus, he's the only one, but he comes twice. He already has come the first time. And so now is the day of salvation. Now is the time to call on the name of the Lord. And whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And whoever comes to him, he will not cast out. And he is with us always, even to the end of the age. He'll never leave us or forsake us. And should he tarry and not return, well, he goes to prepare a place for us there in heavenly glory. And he'll receive us unto himself. And so to be absent from this body is to be present with the Lord Jesus Christ forever and ever. But one day he will return again in all of the glory of the Father and all the holy angels. And he will set up his kingdom, and those who are alive at that time will be with him. And so we'll be with the Lord forever and ever, whether we go to him or he comes back to us. All made possible because he went to the cross and he died for you and me. I'm holding off on verse 28 until next Sunday, because there is a connection to what Jesus is saying and what is certainly a difficult verse, and the verses that follow as we begin chapter 17. And so we hold on to that until next week. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you so much for the free gift of eternal life, the forgiveness of sins that is available to us, Lord, that we profess and claim. And Lord, I pray for all of the believers here, all of the brothers and sisters in Christ. May we take seriously your mandate here, your charge to deny ourselves, all of our self-desires and selfish emotions and will, and surrender completely to you, to your will. May our lives be led daily, and we know, Lord, that we are to die daily with hearts that say, nevertheless, not my will, your will be done. I pray that for all who are here, who know you, and if there are any in our midst who have never been born again, not a child of God yet, have never called on your name, I pray this would be the day, by the power of your Spirit, convicting of sin, righteousness, judgment to come. No one here need die in their sins and face the judgment of God. We know, Lord, whoever comes to you, you'll receive, and I pray if any need to come to you today to be saved, they would do so and call on your name. It's the privacy of their heart and mind, and just, Lord Jesus, save me a sinner. I believe you died and rose again. May it be so, Lord. May you bless us this week as we seek to carry our cross daily, whatever that may be, however it may manifest itself, as we seek to live for you in a fallen, sin-cursed world. In the power of the Spirit, we pray through Jesus' name. Amen.